Welcome to the Social Media Marketing Talk Show. I'm your host this week, Eric Fisher. I am joined by my co-host, Kim Reynolds. Jeff C's in the control room and here on screen and handling simulcasts. And Grace Duffy is our show producer. This is the show for marketers looking to stay on the leading edge of social media. We will cover all the social media that broke in the last few days, all the social media news in particular. This show is brought to you by Social Media Marketing World. You can check out and get tickets and all that kind of great stuff. We've been already talking about it in the pre-show. Through Social Media Marketing World, smmw18.com. In this show, we're going to explore some Facebook publisher changes that occurred, YouTube breaking news about their breaking news segment, and Facebook camera updates, and much, much more in the social media marketing news of the week. Get this show on your calendar. You can do that by going to socialmediaexaminer.com/live show. Literally right there, you have the ability to click add to calendar, and then this show will show up on your calendar, and then you will be reminded that, hey, we're here to hang out and have friends, you know, be your friends and be your newscasters as well every week. And by the way, we are an audio podcast now as well. You can find it on iTunes, Google Play, Stitcher, with new episodes every Monday for you to get caught up on your commute. So one other issue, you can then get the show notes for that podcast as well as this live show all on our Saturday post. So if you go to socialmediaexaminer.com, every Saturday you'll find the replay. You'll find the drill down deep notes of all the stuff that we are talking about here today. And then you can find out, you know, you basically have then the ability to look and see what's going on and dive deeper than we even went here or even interact with us even more. We'd love for you to do that. All right, let's get into the news. There's so much this week. Even though it was a light week in some senses, there was a lot to decipher and drill down into. And right. Jeff, we've got you here because you were the one.
No one else can show up. It was just me. That was the main reason, right?
Yeah, we tried to get so many other people.
Tried to get some expert.
Everybody turned us down. Yeah. Yeah, nobody had big a beard. So no. The issue here, how I knew that you could come talk about this was you said to me, hey, the Social Media Examiner page has this new feature. So I knew you'd already looked at it and I'd already looked at it so we could talk about it. So let's talk about this. What is the new feature? First and foremost, give us the big overview and then we'll start to drill down.
Yeah, so there's a lot of Facebook news we're going to cover this week. But the main thing that we wanted to talk about, and we noticed this, we saw it, and we have a team that like scours the internet every day, and we post new articles in kind of a secret group we have where we show, you know, we talk about what's going to be breaking on this show. And one of them came through, and it's about this new this changes for the kind of for journalists and this kind of, there's multi parts to this, but first of all, one of the things is that a recent study by the Pew Research Center said that only 56% of respondents could recall the source of a link viewed on social sites. So there's all that stuff about fake news, you know, that's been in the media, and Facebook's trying to get on top of that because they were blamed for a lot of the stuff with the election and just, you know, everything going on. Mm-hmm. The fake news is a problem. And so Facebook's kind of been scrambling to answer that. Go ahead.
And we typically do not touch that subject here because it doesn't necessarily have to do with our audience's needs, which is marketing your business or marketing right. your business, community building, all that kind of stuff. That just doesn't touch on it. However, this does, even though it's an answer for that question, that problem, it's definitely something that is of interest to our audience.
Right. And the main thing about this is they're adding logos to the trending section and search because one of the things is that, you know, Facebook, it has this outsized power in the media. It drives more readers to content than any other part of the internet. And it's really kind of scary in some of these media outlets.
Yes.
And they've kind of been impatient with all the stuff that's been going on. So this is what they've done kind of to answer this. So the big thing is publishers' logos are going to show up in articles in the trending and search areas right now in Facebook. And the publishers are going to be able to upload multiple versions of their logo through a thing called the Brand Asset Library. And it's so the logos can appear next to their content on Facebook. It's starting out on trending in a search, and it sounds like it's going to move eventually to some other places. You know, it wouldn't surprise me if some of these big brands, it automatically will put like a logo bug on live video or something like that. Right now, you kind of have to use third-party tools to do that. But I have a feeling later on with this branded assets kind of place where you're putting all this stuff, that kind of stuff will show up later. But right now it's just going to be in trending and search.
All right. So let's dig into this a little bit and talk about why this is such a big deal and why does it matter to marketers? And even what's it going to appear as to the average consumer if they're in their Facebook mobile app or even a non-desktop, I suppose.
Right. So what you'll see on the screen, and we got a screenshot here, but I'll explain it for our listeners, is before you just had these article titles and links, and the image usually show up in like news or in search. Well, now at the bottom of it, you'll see like CNN's logo or CNBC or your brand's logo there. So you know where it's coming from. They're trying to let these trusted sources be seen a lot better, and it'll show up in the feed. So you'll go, okay, this is real news, not the so-called fake news that everybody is talking about and that Facebook kind of got some backlash over. So
yeah.
Where this is, if you want to check to see if you have it or not, like I said, we went to the Social Media Examiner's page and we looked and we saw it. It's under publishing tools. Now it's under your page, your Facebook page. You go under publishing tools, and there at the very, very bottom is a thing that will say branded assets library. And that's where you'll go to add your logos. Now, they're being pretty specific on the logos, because if you'll notice, you really don't have that much real estate, but they want to have it so it's visible. So you get to upload three different versions of your logo. You get to get a colored version, and that's primarily for white backgrounds, a black and white version, and those are you want to do a black version and a white version. Sorry, not black and white. Black version and white version. And so it's going to show up for different colored backgrounds. And this is where I think, when they said it's for images and videos, so that's why I think it's eventually going to go to videos as well. So some of the specifics, you want to have it as a 1:10 horizontal ratio. And they recommend what's called a horizontal lockup version of your logo. And a horizontal lockup version, if you guys don't know what that is, it's actually locked in. That's why they call it a lockup. So you don't want to use any of the assets any different, and it's called lockup because it's the final form of the logo with all of its elements locked into position. So they're trying to maintain consistency between all the mediums, so you don't have a logo where it's just a logo bug and not your text. So for us, Social Media Examiner, it would have Scout, who's our little mascot, mm-hmm. and then the Social Media Examiner on the side of the horizontal logo. So that's kind of what you're wanting to do. The highest resolution they want you to have it is 300 pixels or more is what they're saying is recommended. You really want to make sure it's legible when scaled to different sizes, because on mobile, you're not going to have that much area to look at. They don't want any extra padding around the logo, so you want to make sure you trim it so it's right there. There's no extra pixels, and they don't want any taglines or secondary text. So like for me, mainly pinterestips.com, adding testosterone one pin at a time would be too much. So I just need to put my logo and my kind of lockup image there on the side.
Gotcha. So before people jump in and think, oh, I'm not a big brand, I'm not a, because Facebook doesn't specifically state what a publisher is. And all the examples we see are these, it's CNN, it's the large news outlets. But we got it. Yes.
We're a media thing. And so one of the things that said in there, which really strange, which I never heard of before, and maybe somebody in the comments can let me know, but they said they're piloting this with credibility session attendees. What the heck is that? I have no idea. But so, I guess we're one of them. But
yeah.
If you're a credibility session attendee, you're in luck. But only page admins have access to the brand access tool and add logos. Now, I'm not an admin, but I have certain rights that I've been given with the business manager. So I was able to go in and look at all this stuff. Now, here's the interesting thing too. You are not able to control where the logo appears. These are automatically placed by Facebook. So you can't turn them on or turn them off in certain ways. So it's kind of interesting how that's rolling out. If you do have it, I think you might as well do it. We're in the middle of the process of getting everything lined up, getting all those different types of logos and making sure every asset is the correct one. And we'll be doing that. And as it rolls out, we'll show you some examples of those as we get access to it and we start seeing them. So I don't know how it's going to show up right now. Like I said, it's only trending and in search.
And that's a key piece there is a lot of people are going to say, well, my business is so small, I'm never going to show up in trending. But search is something that if somebody's searching for something, you want to be optimized for right. in terms of visibility and credibility, which is what this is all about. So mm-hmm. I say, go ahead and do it as soon as you are able to. But again, you're going to have whoever is the admin of your Facebook page, go in and check to see if you have this. How do they find out if they have this?
Like I said, you go into publisher settings and then you go into at the very, very bottom. It's called brand asset manager. And so you'll see a new little tab right there that you can look at. I want to bring up a comment that Lori mentioned, and she goes, this is a huge deal. A recent survey of average users shows that people get and trust news on Facebook over MSM. You know, having vetted sources show on the stream helps everyone's credibility, including marketers. So that's a very, very, very good point. I would also add, if you are doing like spammy things like those clickbait articles, you know, they're going to, that will show up now, you know. And so if you have a bad reputation and your logo starts showing up there, it won't be a good thing. So I think it's a good way, a good thing all around. What do you think, Kim? I know you're on Facebook quite a bit.
Well, I think it's good. And I also think that it sounds to me like they are going to be rolling it out to everyone because it says in the article that right now it's just trending in search, but when they say it's eventually going to be extended to all places where people consume news, isn't that going to be all articles? Isn't that what it sounds like to you?
It'd be great if somebody shares your article and as it goes through the news feed for everybody that's going to see that share, that logo shows up. That'd be awesome.
Right.
And, especially since ours is so easily identifiable. I mean, we have great brand recognition and that's, you know, that's a bonus for us.
Yeah.
So I would make sure to do it. I think there's no really minus or negative thing that I can see right now to do that. Ruth says that the Facebook publisher logo requirement sounds similar to the requirements for Facebook instant articles. And we're going to get to some instant article news here kind of in a little bit, but that's a great point. Thanks, Ruth.
I come to think of this as, I don't know if this is just my personal experience, but when I go to Google and I Google something, I search for something and I look to see what the first few results are, I always look to see what the site is. I don't necessarily go to see that it's like an exact match. I go for credibility. I go to look to see like if it's something that's legit. And so I think this is that version of things almost, but with brand recognition and visibility inside of Facebook. Again, a place we're spending so much time these days.
Right. Go ahead.
Sorry. Well, I was going to say, and isn't that kind of interesting that last week or the week before, there was some news that Google was experimenting with taking away the URLs out of search results, and Facebook is going the complete opposite with not only making URLs more visible in search results, but now adding this additional graphic element to the URLs by adding the logo. So, I mean, it's interesting to see what they're doing there.
Yeah.
Right. Jed says that, you know, he doesn't think that everybody will be able to have access to this. And I can see his point because he goes, you know, he doesn't think everybody who has a logo will be able to put it in the newsfeed, which I think makes sense. The point is, and he goes on to say, it's to filter verified sources, not just anyone with a logo. So I think, yes, I think that'll probably happen. I just don't see everybody's logo showing up underneath there. I may be wrong. Maybe Jed's wrong, but I kind of tend to agree with him.
Because well, I think you're a verified source though.
Yeah. I think verified for sure. Yeah. I think that's going to roll out to all verified accounts eventually. That's just me talking, but I don't know about, you know, every small business being able to put their logo on there.
True. All right. Well, let's move on to the next piece of information here, which has to do with another pivot or accommodation that Facebook is giving to these publishers who are kind of tired of Facebook basically cranking down on sending them traffic, because we know that that's been happening less and less as time has gone on.
Right. The big news, and this is from like a big post that Zuckerberg put out, was, he's seeing that people subscribe after seeing news stories on Facebook. Well, now they're actually going to offer subscriptions where people can either do it behind a paywall to get for those instant articles. And Facebook's not going to take a cut, which it's very, very interesting to me. They're going to roll this out to U.S. and then European publishers later this year. But it's publishers who use instant articles. They're able to have a paywall. They're going to have a certain amount of articles per month, which I'm not really sure how that's going to work. Or they can have locked articles, which is kind of the freemium model, like you see the Wall Street Journal do, and some other things. Anyway, the subscribers will be asked, do you want to read more? They'll give a little snippet, and then if you want to read more, and you go to this paywall or freemium model. And the fun, interesting thing is all the payments are going to be processed directly from the publisher's website, and Facebook's not going to take a cut until, not least not now, is what this article said. This is just me, but I think that Facebook will always take a cut eventually. We've seen it with Facebook pages, how they gave everybody all this free traffic, all the stuff you're going to get, and then they started charges to be seen. We're seeing the same thing start to roll out a little bit over on Instagram. If I had a big media agency, I would not put all my eggs in this basket, because I have a feeling eventually Facebook's going to come calling with, wanting some money or a tax or something. So anyway, but it's good now because it's an incentive for publishers to use instant articles rather than just share their links. I've seen one of our friends, Mark Schaefer, one of our speakers at Social Media Marketing World. He does instant articles, and I see that, and he likes using them. His philosophy is, put it out everywhere and let people see it. It's not everybody's model, so it's interesting how they're going to roll this out. So gotcha. a new thing from Facebook.
Yeah. And so they're rolling this out to a small group of US and European publishers later this year. Obviously, again, this is one of those, they're going to give it to the big publishers first. Giving it to the smaller publishers down the road may make sense. We'll see how it shakes up. We'll obviously report back on when it's officially there and how you can get in and get more if this is your thing, if this is the, if you want to get subscriptions.
If you guys have played with instant articles, let us know in the comments, because I'd like to see how many people are actually using instant articles. I know we've had some trainings on them, and there's been some articles on Social Media Examiner about instant articles, but I want to know how many marketers are actually using them and find them useful. I mean, I don't know about you guys, but
yeah,
it's just like a one more step you have to go through to put your content out. And I understand for the big media agencies, but for the smaller and maybe local businesses, I don't know the value of instant articles other than it loads faster. So what are your thoughts, Eric? What do you think about that?
I will say this, every time that I do load up an instant article, the experience is so much better than clicking through and then being transferred over to someone's website inside of a Facebook built-in mobile app browser, et cetera. I'll often, open up, if I do, I'll often open up that browser and then hit open in Safari. So then it's there, and then I can read it there instead of inside Facebook. But that's just me.
Yeah. So it's interesting, our comments. And I wanted to just, Kristen says, not me. And then Ruth said, I have tried instant articles and I found it to be very complicated. So I think that's a lot of people's kind of thoughts. Just like, is the benefit worth the amount of time we're going to have to spend in to get this out of there? So it'll be interesting to see how this rolls out.
Yeah. Well, let's move into some other Facebook news. Before we get to that, I want to say thank you to Social Media Marketing World, which I'm just used to as a podcaster, thanking my sponsors that way. But we are Social Media Marketing World. That's what's funny. Jeff, you're going to be there. You're going to be speaking. And we've got, how many speakers do we have locked in already? Wait.
Over 120, I believe.
Yeah. It's more than that.
I know
that
we have 150 sessions.
Okay.
So,
it's huge, guys. It's gonna, if you've been at all in the past however many years. I mean, we've been doing it for what, 5, 6, 7? This is like year 6 or 7. I'm six. Blanking. Year 6. The past 5 years are going to feel pretty small compared to this one for all the stuff that we can't even tell you about. Anyways.
Right. and one thing you can't talk about, but it's going to be so cool. I cannot wait until we announce it.
Don't. That's not fair. Kim, come on.
It's so cool.
Jeez. Oh, it's going to be great. Can't tell you.
What were you going to say, Jeff?
I actually went before I had anything to do with Social Media Examiner. I went when my beard was like this, when I was small. And really, it does. It can change your business. You know, meet so many cool people. So that's even before I even became part of the team. It's awesome. It's true. So, same here.
I went before I worked here. You can join us by going to smmw18.com. It's going to be awesome. All right, let's get into the rest of this Facebook news. So Facebook allows select business pages to share stories. Is this legit?
We have a sighting in the wild where this was seen.
Yes.
But I went and looked, and yeah, it's true. This Kim, person
try reloading that. See if that comes up.
It looks like it's coming from stories, like a stories. This story is coming from a page. The only thing is, you know, of course, I'm like, I want to see if I have it. And the interesting thing is, aren't they phasing out the page manager app on Facebook? Is that true that I heard?
Not the page manager app, the groups app.
The groups apps. Okay. So I went to the Facebook pages and looked at it. And I'm trying to figure out how you will even go to the camera app, where you'll do for your page. Do you go into
They'll add it. I mean, there wasn't live in there, and then there was. So.
Yeah, but there's no even, you have to go to your camera roll and all this stuff when you're doing in the manager app. So I don't know where it's going to come from or how it's going to go or how you're going to use it, but I don't have it. We have one person, and it looks like when you went to Calvin's holidays page, it was in a different language. So that may be rolling out, you know, how Facebook kind of tests it.
Yeah. I assume it's a test in a certain location, but it is legit. I went through and found that page. And sure enough, I liked the page, went back in my mobile app to the very beginning of the mobile app in Facebook, scrolled up to the top, and there it was in my stories. And it was a page that I liked, not a person. Recently, we saw that they changed over from Facebook stories being available only for friends that you have to being that anybody you follow publicly, you would then see there. Or for the ability, I should say, for profiles to allow their stories to be viewed publicly. This is that next step that everybody's just kind of like, oh, give me stories for my page. I want stories for my page.
Right. Yeah.
Which is what essentially Instagram stories already has had since basically the beginning. All accounts had it on Instagram stories at the beginning, right?
My thing is, until they consolidate everywhere you can put a story at, I don't know how valuable it will be for a page, to be honest. I mean, I can see some of it, but really, I mean, it's just, there's so many places to look for stuff. I mean, Instagram would be the place if I had a client, that's what I would tell them to do.
Well, and there's been even earlier this week, there were some people that I was following that I'm friends with on Facebook that were saying they were only just now seeing Facebook stories, the top tab of the mobile browser, show up at all for them. And I'm like, wow, I didn't know that people didn't have that up there at all. Right. And so, yeah, that was pretty odd to me.
Yeah.
So
thanks to Martin for sharing this with us. His find. That's pretty cool.
Yeah. So, I mean, obviously this is going to come through. Facebook is, well, let's get into the rest of the news because Facebook is still trying to get us to use the camera as well as Facebook stories more than we are. So what other news do we have in this area?
Yeah, so there's a really cool thing. I like this because I went and I got the update last night, and so I had it this morning. Facebook has now the 360 photo, and so now users can capture 360 photos from within the latest version of the Facebook mobile app and instantly upload them to their timeline or their album or in groups or even, which is really, really cool, use them as a cover photo on their personal profile. That's personal profile, not your business page. So I went and did it. If you are familiar with how the iPhone does the panoramic stuff, it's pretty much the same kind of thing. And you have a little area where you're supposed to hold your phone and you just pretty much pan around in an entire circle. And then you're able to share that in all those places. So I could share to my timeline. I was going to do it in my office, but I have like a cone of cleanliness that only is clean, like you can see at the camera. So if I went around, it was horrible. So I didn't share that publicly. So yeah, so it's really, really cool. It's going to be really great for like when you're on vacation. The video they showed is actually a lady in front of the, I think it was the Golden Gate Bridge, panning around and sharing with her family at home. It's going to be really cool for that way. That way, if you're at an event or something like that or a concert, I think it's going to be a really cool way. It was super simple to use. I had a little trouble at first with it stitching things together properly, and it missed kind of some spaces. I just needed to slow down. So it's very, very cool. The other thing is you can tag your friends in that. So if you're like in a group, you're out at a party or something and you do a 360, you can actually go in and tag your friends in that photo.
Very cool.
Yeah, it's really, really cool. I thought it was a really cool feature, and you can actually hold it. And, you know, if somebody else gets your photo, they can pan around like they were there and see what it looks like. It's for all iOS and Android users. It should be able to take and share these photos starting this week. Like I said, I got it yesterday. I got it this morning when I woke up and looked at it, and it's very, very cool.
Very cool. So
let me tell you where to find it. When you go to the app, you look and you have to scroll down because, you know, there's so many things now you can do with Facebook. You scroll down and look for the 360 photo icon within the menu of your status bar to open up the feature. And then you press the blue button to start, and it walks you through everything else.
Interesting. Okay. Well, I'm hoping that's something that is useful, because ultimately Facebook's, I mean, this isn't VR, but it's almost like being there.
I mean, it's really cool. I mean, it's just, I think it's another just, I think it's a feature that a lot of people will use.
Yeah. All right. What other features have they been rolling out here?
Another thing with the camera. So they've been rolling out live GIF or GIF, however you want to say it. And I'm sure people will let us know in the comments, and text sharing. So you tested out the text sharing. So you want to explain kind of that, Eric? Because that was kind of fun.
So if you have your mobile device open, you swipe to have the camera open up inside of your mobile Facebook app. And then at the top, you've got the option to go live. You've got GIF. You've got, what was the other one? A GIF. Did I say GIF? Anyway. And then there was, now there's text. And it's literally just like you've seen them roll out on desktop and mobile, where you've got this solid color background, and then you've got the text that you can put on it. It's kind of like a poor man's text quote image, you know, where they don't have any kind of texture or anything like that. I mean, I know they rolled out some of those, but it's and they do call people's attention a lot, but in my personal opinion, it's still very much overused. So seeing it here in stories, I guess I could see it being worthwhile to drop in and be a title marker if you're telling an actual story made up of stories clips. I'm gonna recant a little bit saying I hate this. I think it makes more sense in stories, because you can't do it as easy in like Instagram stories to do that same thing. So,
Well, the cool thing is too, is, now you can drop these kind of effects into Facebook stories, direct messaging, and also the traditional news feed. So you're not just limited to stories. You can do all those things. The update is available for iOS and Android. The one thing I noticed is I got the update last night and GIF creation is gone. So I had everything else, but the GIF thing, and The Verge mentioned in the article that they were testing that. The thing is, I was able still to do kind of a GIF with the video that automatically loops. So I don't know if they're going to drop it, because you used to swipe over and be able to have it, but it's gone for me now.
Yeah. So I never had it at all.
That's going to play out of there.
Yeah.
What were you saying, Eric?
I said, I never had the GIF or GIF, however people are pronouncing it. Let's just stop talking about that. Hello? Can you hear me? Hello? Hello? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
I can hear you.
Okay. Jeff doesn't hear me. Okay, great. Sorry. Had to make sure moving forward. I think Jeff's headphones were having an issue. Anyway, what I was trying to say was, I never had the GIF or the GIF functionality whatsoever. So that I know Mike had that, and he was playing around with it. Again, they were testing out all these things. This is one, however, I think that is a solid, like, yes, they are definitely rolling it out. It is something that Facebook has announced officially saying that it is coming. So hopefully, you know, you should be able to have this now. I mean, there was literally a Facebook update for my app yesterday. So go check it out.
The other thing is they were saying that this is probably going to, you know, they're trying to make it more for teens. I don't know if you said that or not, but that was kind of, a lot of people think that's the reasoning. It's because they're trying to make it like the Instagram story camera, and they're trying to make it a little more interactive, attractive to teens looking for ways to share visually. I don't know. My kids think Facebook is for old people, and so I don't know how good that will be or not.
Yeah, we'll see. All right. We've got another whole segment here. We'll talk about YouTube, but in a second. For now, I want to mention again, this show is brought to you by Social Media Marketing World. Kim, you can't tell us anything about all the awesome stuff that's coming, but what are you looking forward to most about Social Media Marketing World?
I'm looking forward to seeing all of the friends that I've met over the years and seeing them again. And I'm also looking forward to some of the Facebook ad sessions because they're my favorite. So.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, we've got stuff that's breaking all throughout. I'm most curious, what are we going to have to scramble to make sure we have sessions on that has not even been announced yet in this world of social media, because it happens every year. Trust me.
Oh, yeah.
And then we have sessions on it. So
Periscope broke 1 year. Wasn't that one of them?
That's true. Broke? Periscope was announced
the day before.
So I think it was about 3 years ago now, something like that. Anyway, so that is yet another reason why you have to plan now to go then, because we will have the up-to-date information and speakers ready to speak on it. So smmw18.com. So Jeff, there's breaking news about YouTube, breaking news.
I know there's all sorts of stuff. So, okay. One of the cool things is YouTube is testing a new mobile playback interface. So, what it is, and we have a screen share here and I'll try to explain what's going on, is that they're trying to give users a little bit more control over how, when they do playback, you know. So right now, anytime you minimize a video, it goes to the bottom and you kind of have it there. Well, now users will see a dedicated playback buttons next to the thumbnail. And the new layout includes the standard, you know, the X button to close clips and a separate play pause button. So it's not huge news. I just think it's a lot smaller, and it also has the title alongside of the video there. So it's not a huge thing. I kind of wish that it was a little bit bigger. And also, I wish I could snap it to the corners. If, like on my iPad, if I have a movie open or something, it shrinks down and I can actually move it to where I want it to be. Mm-hmm. This, it just drops it to the bottom like it does now, but it's smaller, gives you the title, but it does have a little play and stop button. It's a little kind of thing. It's supposed to roll out across all the different devices. It's interesting. They say it's coming to all users, and then another article said, well, we can't confirm that because not everybody has it yet. So I don't have it yet. I thought I did, and I don't, because it's not that big of a deal, I don't think, other than it's just a little bit more ease of use. You know, so there's not really any way to know if it's going to roll out to everybody.
Is it doing away with the ability to see the video still playing down in the corner while you swipe through the app?
Because from what I was able to see in the articles, it's just a lot smaller. I mean, you can kind of see it in that thumbnail there. You see the title off to the right, and then there's that little square. It's just smaller. I don't know if I like the smallness factor or not, especially on a phone. Yeah. Now on my iPad, okay.
The images I saw made it feel like it was more hidden and less viewable, which I guess if you're listening to audio, that's one thing. But if you're watching it, well, I guess if you're scrolling through and you're watching a video already, like you're
ready to go to the next one.
Yeah, exactly. So it's a minor.
I
mean,
I guess I'm glad they're doing the close quickly one and the play, because sometimes you'll find another one and you want to get rid of it. You don't have to swipe up and swipe it to the left or whatever you have to do now.
That's true.
It just makes it a little bit easier. So I think the X to close is probably the thing I think is the coolest. So, but like I said, I wish they would let me snap it to wherever I want, but Google, if you're listening,
totally agree.
Call me. So,
all right. And then in other YouTube news, YouTube is in the news business, sort of.
Right.
They're showing breaking news interestingly enough.
Yeah, and I, once again, I swear I thought I had this, but I went to check, and I thought with all the hurricane stuff that's going to slam Texas from where I'm at, they'll be there, but it's not. So it looks a lot like the recommended kind of playlist that you get if you go to your channel and you see all the people you subscribe to, and then there's like a recommended kind of line of horizontal videos. I think there's like, depending on where you're at, like three or four of them. But now they're going to bring breaking news, and some people have said that it's there all the time, and then other people have said that, other articles have said that it's only when they have breaking news. So it's really unclear
if
it's like, if it's going to be a worldwide event and Google decides to put it there, or how it's going to work. You know, Google is populating in this section, or the, if it's going to be like automatic, or if somebody's curating it by hand, or, you know, if it's going to only come during the breaking news cycle. So
yeah.
I like having those kind of breaking news, as long as it doesn't take away something that I want. But if there's there, I mean, because that's why I swore that I had it, because I was saw something and I watched it because it was about some news article. And so I think it's a good idea, especially on the mobile app where, you know, you have some your real estate is kind of limited. I kind of like having that to see what's happening in the world.
I was kind of curious to see if this was going to show up in the smart TVs or smart TV devices, mm-hmm. like the Apple TV, the Fire TV, the Roku, in those right. YouTube apps there, because much like scrolling up and down and having a whole category that you can go left to right in, like on YouTube, where you've got, you know, watch it again or breaking news, you know, breaking news would be one of them. And that would be pretty interesting to be able to then just sit there and go through these different videos. But again, this is still something that's being tested. So we don't have concrete right. information that like this is the way it will be when it rolls out. We're just seeing screenshots of desktop use and mobile use, and not even sure that it's going to stay there permanently. So,
right.
But we're interested in seeing, you know, how this plays out.
I like, you know, if they only do it by, you know, like some breaking news, like the hurricane or a disaster, I think it's good to just keep people informed. You know, I don't know how many times, if you guys use the breaking news tab on, you know, that you see on Facebook desktop, if that's right. something that catches your eye to use, you know, every once in a while, if something big is going on, I'll see that. And again, back to our earlier topic, I think that's really cool to have those logos there so you can tell that's from a trusted source. But I like the breaking news stuff. I just think it's a way to keep people informed, or if there's an emergency or whatever. So
true. So then one other key piece of YouTube information that came out this week has to do with actually with something we reported on a few weeks ago, a few months ago, I can't remember. Right. Amazon's influencer program, they are opening it up to YouTube creators.
Yeah, it's really interesting. It's there, you know, it's been in beta for a while. And they are just opening up now to, like you said, just verified YouTube people. So they want, they had it for like a self-service tool for YouTube influencers. Now they have, you can go to their site, and I'm sure Grace is going to put the link in, and you get to become part of their influencer program. The cool thing is with the influencer program is you get your own page on Amazon, and you get an exclusive vanity URL. And so I think that's the biggest thing right there. It lets you showcase your products, you recommend to your followers. You can promote that URL and make it easy for your followers to, you know, find your recommendations and earn money on those purchases. So the way you do it is you go to the get started, and then your walkthrough kind of, you know, you got to show your social identity, and then they check your eligibility, and you have to have a YouTube account, of course. But they did mention that other ways to qualify will be added in the future. So I see this going to be rolling out as well to like Instagram influencers yeah. and people who have huge Facebook followers and all that stuff. So, but to go back to that vanity URL, which I think is so important, it's really big for YouTubers because they can just say it. They don't have to put up a graphic. They can say this short little, and I guess it's really easy to say from what I've been able to ascertain that, it's an easy way for them to direct traffic there. So they don't have to throw up a card or do anything like that. So right now, like you'll see people like What's Up Mom, Mark Cuban, Felicia Day. Those are kind of the big people who are on this program right now. We don't know how many people signed up under the beta program, but those are kind of the big ones. The interesting thing too, is that they don't necessarily earn higher commissions. So it's not some special thing like if you have your book on there, Eric, or something you're promoting on your podcast, they're not going to earn more money than you would from what it looks like. It's just they get that URL for them to really send people there quickly and easily. So
gotcha.
That's kind of the big thing with the influencer program. So, and even Aminoson says it's because of the being able to say it verbally. So,
okay. Very interesting. I'm interested to see how this continues to roll out. Again, they're doing that gradual or in waves type of a rollout where at first right. It was, you know, highly vetted people. And now it's the YouTube creators who are also verified in some certain ways. And, you know, we'll right. see. Again, as with other stories of this nature, there will be more stories that release future changes to this, and we will have them for you. So
right, and this may tie into when I was on a couple weeks ago talking about Amazon Spark, which is their kind of social media Instagram-ish platform that they're trying out. You know how that's going to tie in as well. Is it, you know, can they use their vanity URL on their Spark profile or when they're sharing products to Spark, Amazon Spark? That may factor in as well. One thing I will say, if this is even an interest to you to go sign up and just get in the process, I'm actually on a thing called Amazon Merch where you can sell merchandise like t-shirts and stuff. And it was like a 3 to 6 month wait. And it took that long. There was, you know, once you signed up, it's just they're processing through stuff. So if you're interested in that and you have any sort of YouTube following, I'd go ahead and sign up and get the process started. And even if you don't get in this initial wave, they kind of do tier kind of things. They'll let some people in and then they'll wait a while and then let some more people in. So if you have any interest in that, that's what I would do.
Very cool, Jeff. Well, Jeff, thank you for being here for these three segments and let everybody know where they can find you.
I am Jeff C. everywhere on the interwebs. That's Jeff, and the last name is spelled S is in Sam, I-E-H, I before E, especially in C. And you can find me at manlypinteresttips.com, where we're always adding testosterone one pin at a time.
Awesome.
See you guys. Jeff,
thanks for being here. All right. We've got some other less large news to go through. So, Kim, why don't you take it away with this first one?
Okay. So, in the coming weeks, Facebook will begin demoting stories in the news feed that feature either fake video play buttons embedded in their images or videos that only have a static image. And so you can kind of see that right here in this image. It appears to be a video, but it's not. It just is an image with a fake little play button. And if you click it thinking you're going to watch a video, you're actually going to be taken to a low quality website. So 2 minute a day workout, you have been called out by Facebook, which yes. is kind of embarrassing, I would think.
Yeah, because this image there was an image that was in the Facebook announcement of this, and they literally show this 2 minute a day workout site doing an example of this where it's, you know, the dumbbells all in a row and then there's a play button, but it's not really a play button. It's just a trick to tap that play button and take you to the article. So the other version of this, though, this is the image with the play button. The other version is it's an actual video that just keeps looping or something. Right. It's
a static image that just, I guess, just plays that same image over and over and over again. I don't even understand what the point of that would be. But I guess it's just Facebook has seen that spammers use these deceptive practices to trick people into clicking onto.
Yeah.
Low quality websites. And so
it's a little bit like the fake live stuff where it's shows up as live, but it's not really live. This is a similar version. It's different varieties of that same scamminess.
Exactly. So Facebook's doing the smackdown.
Yeah. In other news, WhatsApp has also rolled out the colorful text status update feature. So if you're a WhatsApp user, you too can now also create white text on a colored background if that's your thing. So we'll see.
Okay. And Twitter is having, well, not just Twitter, but it's the 10th anniversary of the hashtag that started on Twitter. And here, okay, so I lobbied to show this tweet because this was the first tweet that featured a hashtag. And so I thought y'all might be interested in seeing the first hashtag ever. And this is it. This is the tweet. Yeah. And this is the guy that is the father of the hashtag, Chris Messina. And so this is the daddy of the hashtag. And yeah, we all know the hashtag is. So this is it, the 10-year anniversary of the hashtag.
He even states it. His first use, it's, how do you feel about using pound? I think it's funny that even in parentheses, he has to put the word pound so people yeah know how to say that hashtag. How about using that for groups, as in hashtag Barcamp? And again, Barcamp is a version of WordCamp and PodCamp, these unconferences that were around mostly back in the time of 2007 when this was birthed into existence, yeah, and then used for all social media. So
I wonder when hashtag actually became a word to describe that
pound pretty sign. Soon after. It wasn't very long after. So
yeah.
Yeah.
So wow, that's kind of cool. I'm geeky yeah enough to think that's cool.
Yeah. Google is rolling out 6-second video previews on mobile search. So an example of how this is going to look is if you open up Google and you're searching for something in your mobile device and the search results come up, there are those, what, like I was describing earlier, when it comes to YouTube in the mobile or the desktop or even the TV version of YouTube, where which is also similar to how Netflix is laid out, by the way. When you're searching on a TV, you see rows of horizontal choices, and you can scroll up and down, and then you see those bars. Well, this is like that, only you see a row or a scrollable. It's almost like a carousel. That's a better way to put it. Sorry, long way around to getting that. It's basically like a video carousel, except the video is actually playing for about 6 seconds. And once you get to that point, it kind of entices you to, oh, there's video, there's movement, and you can actually press play and then watch that. So video results inside of Google search with 6-second playback is basically what it is.
I think that's kind of cool.
Yeah.
So Reddit has come out with an extended rollout of their beta video player. So native video within Reddit app, and wow, I've totally bungled this up. I'm sorry, people. Users will be able to natively record video within the official Reddit app on mobile or upload pre-recorded video on mobile and desktop with Reddit. And they also have a GIF making tool with Reddit, which is actually really neat. And so I'm also have to apologize. My computer's having issues and all of these screen shares are either not loading or loading really slowly. So we were going to show you some really cool Reddit video, and it was a really cute puppy, and the puppy was playing with Pokemon. So that's what you would be seeing, a cute puppy playing with little Pokemon stuffed animals.
My question here is why does video need to be put on Reddit? I don't know. Anyway.
So you can watch puppies play with Pokemon.
Apparently. So, yeah.
Which is better than kittens playing with Pokemon. So there.
Yeah. Well, we do need to move on. Sorry.
Okay.
And okay, so Facebook is introducing a dedicated section for safety check. This is a single place where you can go safety check all of your it has to do with ongoing current events. So if there's something that's going on, like a fire, a train accident, different things like that, they are allowing you to now, and they're rolling this out gradually to users as of a few days ago, and it's going to be complete over the next coming weeks. You will be able to go into that option immediately to be able to alert those and your loved ones that you're okay.
Cool. Well, I know we've been talking about LinkedIn native video a lot lately, and so our latest update is that it is now rolling out globally to all members over the coming weeks. And Jeff just mentioned that he got it last night, so you might want to check your LinkedIn app to see if you have it, because it is rolling out to everyone now. So I don't have it yet. So
I do. In other video news, something that we talked about last week is the Facebook Watch segment. And DigiDay is reporting that the video series on Facebook are already driving a higher engagement rate than the standalone videos that are uploaded and shared to the site. And so according to these stats, I would say that these Facebook series of videos that are on this new watch format and platform that they've rolled out are starting to indicate success.
Cool. So Snapchat has confirmed that it will likely be pushing scripted content through its Snapchat shows by the end of the year. And they want to state that they are not trying to take away audiences from TV. Rather, they are engaging a whole new audience that doesn't consume TV at the same rate. And so they're going to bolster the traditional TV consumption instead of replacing it. So what they're saying is that this audience of 25-year-old and younger aren't watching TV the way they used to, and they're going to offer something new for that audience. And that kind of rolls into the next little news mention we have here, that after its first month of being broadcast, NBC's twice-daily news show called Stay Tuned has captured 29 million unique viewers. And it kind of is related to that because all of these viewers are, for the most part, under 25 years old. And this is a new type of news segment that is really appealing to this younger demographic. And Snapchat wants to take advantage of that and bring out these new types of shows that are less than 5 minutes and grab that short attention span of these young viewers. So I think it's kind of exciting, this new, they consider it a whole new type of viewing experience. And one caveat here, they're saying that this new TV program had triple the number of viewers than the NBC Nightly News with Lester Holt program. And that's not necessarily a fair comparison, given that Snapchat counts a view as soon as the video opens. So they're saying that as soon as the video opens, that's counted as one viewer, as one view, and that they're triple the number of views who watch the NBC Nightly News. But that's not really, it's kind of like Apple
count, that's like if you're flipping channels, they count it as, did you land it on the channel for a second or two?
Exactly. So it's not really the same, but it is kind of interesting what they plan on doing here. And it is opening up a whole new market.
Interesting. Facebook is announcing an upcoming 2017 Global Partner Summit that will be held in San Francisco, October 4th and 5th. This is an annual event. And this is where Facebook announces their product roadmaps for Facebook itself, Instagram, Messenger, etc. So heads up, there will be Facebook, Instagram, and Messenger news in October, the beginning of October, and brace yourself.
Yay. Well, three members of Oculus, Facebook's VR division, published a patent application for a waveguide display with two-dimensional scanner, which can augment wearer's view of the environment. So basically what they have done is they've filed a patent for smart glasses that will display images, video, and work with connected speakers and a headphone to play audio when worn. So we have someday able to look forward to smart glasses that can view in AR and maybe VR.
Interesting. Yeah. And if you remember a few months ago, at F8, Facebook did a lot of, well, not only VR, but AR stuff, augmented reality stuff with the phone itself, like the artwork on the side of the wall at Facebook that you could only see because you were holding up your Facebook app to it or the Facebook camera app to it. Yeah. So this I could see being working in conjunction with that.
Well, yeah. I mean, Mark Zuckerberg said that he believes that virtual and augmented reality devices have the potential to replace smartphones and PCs as a computer platform completely. And I mean, that seems hard to believe but I mean, that's what he believes the future is. So, and there he's putting a lot of money into it.
Very interesting. Well, that is our last piece of news. Again, we would love it for you to hit share on this or subscribe to this on Facebook and make sure to check out the recap, the social media marketing talk show recap publishing every Saturday, socialmediaexaminer.com. Every Saturday, you'll find the links to everything we mentioned here, the notes of everything we discussed on today's episode. And again, make sure to find our new audio podcast of this show in iTunes, Google Play, and Stitcher, with new episodes publishing every Monday. Few important notes. Our next show is next Friday, September 1st, 2017 at 10 a.m. Pacific. We'll drop the link in the show notes and the show notes on Saturday. And you can also get this on your calendar. Go to socialmediaexaminer.com/live show. This will add this show to your calendar so that you can join us for live shows. And you can subscribe to future updates that way, as well as follow us on Crowdcast and all our social channels to get future show updates. That is it for this episode of the Social Media Marketing Talk Show, and we will see you next time. Thanks, everybody.